get blessed beyond blessed today because we have a very, very special guest in the house to bring the word today. Let me tell you how special this guy is, okay? So about a month and a half ago, Pastor Mike and I are at the Calvary Pastors Conference, and this guy gets up and he starts to talk, and there is just a knit between the two of us. And I can just tell that this brother is my brother from a different mother. And I just lean over to Mike and I go, I want that guy. I want that guy to come and bring what God has given to him. So I want you to welcome right now my buddy Dave Z, Dave Zamora. Welcome up right now.
Yeah.
You know, it's very rare that we have a chance to have a member of the Taliban in church, you know what I mean? And to be able to preach and share what it goes from killing people to, no, just kidding. But my brother is going to share with you an incredible story. But we just want you to see whether you're a surfer in slippers or a cholo in chucks, it's all about Jesus. And one faith, one hope, one Lord, one baptism. Amen? All right, guys, give your hearts to this man. He is going to bring the word. Bring it, my brother.
Hey, thank you. Well, it's a blessing to be here, as it has been the last couple of services, last night and now. And it's been a blessing. We got here, me and my wife got here on Monday and got to speak at a couple of churches since we've been here. And it's just been a great time in the Word, and also just a blessing to come and impart the Word of God and share with you guys. And we've had a blast. I got to eat some of the you know, local food here. You know, I ate a loco moco. Yeah, that's all right until you know what that means where I come from. Moco is booger. So when I went up to order this thing, I told the lady, I says, do you know what a moco is? And she's like, no, you know. And I says, well, where I come from, moco is booger. And loco is crazy, so I ate a crazy booger. So I tried it, and it was crazy, you know, and I can't wait to get back to the church and tell them, hey, you know what, I was eating crazy boogers back. Yeah, it just sounds a little bit, you know, but anyways, I had one, and it was pretty good, I must say. But it's been a blessing being here and just, you know, kind of looking at everything. This morning when we woke up, I was looking, we have an ocean type of view, and I told my wife, it would be hard to be a pastor here on Sunday mornings. Look how beautiful it is out here. You know, it's like, you go where you come, where I come from, nothing like it. Trust me, you want to be in church and you want to go and hang, but here it's just like everything, everywhere you're looking, it's just, because it's our first time to Hawaii. We've never been, ever. So we're just like, you know, like we're at the Getty Center. We're just looking around at everything like, man, you know. So it's been a blessing, and the weather has been perfect. It's like 117 back home, you know. And there in San Bernardino is where the fires are at right now, and people in our fellowship have been affected by it. And there's fires every summer out there, and so it's just one of these things, and fire season. But over here, you know, 80 degrees is like ideal for me, you know, perfect. You know, so, but it's been a blessing, and this fellowship here has been gracious in the time that we've been here. And so, yes, I would love to come back. You know, it's just like I told my wife, you know, yeah, a little bit of time of leisure, relaxing, but also teaching in the Word, and it's just been a tremendous, tremendous blessing. So I want you guys this morning to open up your Bibles to the book of Hebrews, and I want to share with you out of Hebrews chapter 11. And we'll be looking at verses 8 all the way down to about verse 19. And we're going to just consider the life of an individual by the name of Abraham. We all know who he is, the father of faith. And there's a couple of passages that I'm going to go to before we get into that. But just a little bit about myself. Me and my wife just celebrated here last month, 17 years of marriage. We have 3 kids, and we planted a church there in the Southern California area. And the Lord has really just blessed the ministry. Our church is Living Way Christian Fellowship, and God's just doing a great work. We have, you know, a multicultural church. It's a growing fellowship, and we minister a lot to those that are, you know, struggle with addiction and in and out of prison and so on and so forth. I myself spent about 5.5 years in the California prison system, and you know, lived a life of drug addiction for a good period of time, and the Lord delivered me from a life of meth and heroin, and completely a radical deliverance. And so this is the type of community and people that the Lord has brought us to. Now you would think, because of my background and because of just the whole, you know, gangs in prison, that our church would be filled with these types of people, and it's actually not. There's just a handful. But the Lord has brought, you know, retired law enforcement and retired correctional officers. These are the elders and leaders in the church. It's so funny because they got their stories and I got mine. You know what I mean? It's like, hey, you know, they're like, I remember chasing a guy. I remember getting chased by a cop. You know, that's kind of how the stories go. You know what I mean? But you know, the Lord has been very gracious to us and it's been a blessing. And the Lord's opened up some amazing doors. We have an 8-bed facility, a recovery home where we house men for a year. It's a year commitment discipleship program. And the church where I now pastor is a building that I was very familiar with because across the street from the church was the parole office for 20 years. So I used to be in front of the parole office waiting to give my drug test to meet my parole officer, and I'd see this church sitting right on the corner, and never thought in my wildest dreams, now I'm the senior pastor of that church. And then the parole office, now I'm looking at the parole office from the other side, right, as the pastor, and looking at that, and not too long ago the parole office actually moved out, and so the building became kind of, you know, became vacant. And so Just within this last year, we acquired a majority of the building, almost 17,000 square feet, and we started the 2-year Calvary Chapel Bible College there, and also a 2-year general ed accredited general ed college, all taught from a biblical worldview. So all of our professors are adjunct. They come from the major 4-year Christian universities in the area. They teach in the evenings for our students, and it's just a blessing. And our church offices are where the parole office was. So my office is where me and my parole officer used to meet. That's my office now. So it's amazing to see what the Lord does. Amen. And as you trust in the Lord and just seek the Lord, it's amazing to see the work that God does. And another thing, I didn't mention this in the other services, but you know, with that, when I first became the pastor of the church, there was the parole office was still in operation. So I'd see a lot of guys that I was in prison with and stuff. And so we would start to talk. And the next thing you know, I became close friends with one of the parole agents there. And my old parole officer saw me. It was funny. One morning I'm walking into the church and I just hear my last name, Zamora. And it was like a voice of authority, right? So I stopped a little bit, but then I thought like, man, I ain't breaking the law. I ain't going to turn around, man, you know? So I kind of did one of those cool ones, you know what I mean? Where I just kind of walked and just looked real quick, and I just seen him standing there. So I stopped and I says, hey, how you doing? And he's just like, I thought that was you. He says, what are you doing? And these were my exact words. I turn around, I go, what are you doing? He said, well, I'm at work. I said, well, so am I. And I walked in the church. About 3 days later, he comes, he walks in the church, and he begins to ask, he says, are you serious? You're the pastor? I says, yeah, man. He's like, do they know who you are? You know, kind of thing. So anyways, to make a long story short, I actually became a state parole chaplain. I am the second convicted felon in the state of California to wear a badge and become a state parole chaplain. I'm actually... It's a blessing to be able to do that. And then also the first convicted felon to go through Ben Clark Sheriff's Academy in Riverside and graduate the academy. First convicted felon. Pretty mind-blowing. You know, I remember when I first got there, you know, I got these tattoos. They're old tattoos, prison tats, you know. And so I went in long sleeves, and it was hot out there, you know. And it was like, you know, and I'm just like, man, you know, I told my wife, man, there's sheriffs everywhere. We call them hoodas. It's a slang word for, you know, police. I'm like, there was hoodas everywhere, you know. My wife's like, well, it is an academy, you know. And so, you know. So anyways, I'm there, and I got these tattoos on this hand, you know, and so I'm like, keep this hand in the pocket the whole time, and I'm riding like this, and we're in this thing, and then it's funny, there's one guy who was like a reserve officer, but he was a pastor, and he was reserved, so because he was a pastor, I start like conversating with him, you know, during one of our breaks, and so then, I don't know, I just started going into my testimony, and he's like, wait, he's all, you were in prison? And I was like, yeah, bro. Then it dawned on me, like, this guy's a cop. And he's like, how did you get in here? I was like, shh, wait. Let's talk this out here, you know, kind of thing. And he's like, that's crazy. You're a convicted felon in here. I'm like, hey, bro, relax. The Lord's in this. I had to bring it back to Jesus, kind of calm him down and let him know it. And remind him that God works in this dynamic. He was so floored and so blown away. And so that's kind of been our ministry there at Living Way Christian Fellowship. And to be able to be on both sides of the fence now and minister to those that are coming out of prison, and also for law enforcement to call upon you and say, hey, Dave, we need you over here. I've been in groups this size educating law enforcement on gang culture and so on and so forth in prison and all that because they desire to know. It's mind-blowing. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 1. God takes the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. He takes the base things of the... Guys, listen, the things that aren't, right? listen, that's what the Lord is doing with the ministry there. So it's exciting. It's a blessing. And the Lord's been very gracious to us. And me and my wife, we're just enjoying everything that the Lord is doing in and there. So pray for us. Pray as we continue to cover ground. And this Monday, that's why I have to get back. Classes start. Our fall quarter starts. And so I like to be there, and I like to shake the students' hands as they're going into their first classes for the fall quarter. And so be praying for us as the Lord just continues to grow and expand. We've been able to plant 3 churches already out of our church. And the church has doubled in size in the last year, and it's just a blessing to see what God is doing. But we also believe that our philosophy of ministry is we reach them, we teach them, we mend them, and then we send them. And that's the whole point of it, you know. It's just to get the gospel out there and lead people to Christ. And so be praying for us. Amen? Amen. What I want to do this morning is I want to kind of start off here in chapter 10. And I want you just in your notes to jot down 2 verses that we're going to look at in chapter 10 that I believe will kind of lay the foundation of where we are here this morning. In verses 23 and verse 24. Now remember that clearly the book of Hebrews is really an entire book that's written in regards to preaching Christ, that Christ is greater. And clearly Christ is greater. He's really the fulfillment of all the things that the writer of Hebrews is kind of displaying as they're looking back. And he's saying Christ is greater than the sacrifices. Christ is greater than the priesthood. Christ is greater. That all these things pointed to Christ. And so here's the point that's being made that I think when we talk on the area of faith this morning. Now notice what happens here. The Bible says in verse 23, it says, "Let us hold fast the confession of our hope." Let us hold fast. Let us cling to. Let us hold on to. And I think the point that's being made here is that we have everything we need in Christ. And we're to hold on to it with a grip that is so powerful. Hold fast. Notice the confession of our hope. What is this hope that the writer of Hebrews is speaking of? Jesus is the ultimate fulfillment of the hope of Scripture. Jesus is that hope. Remember what the Bible says in the book of Ephesians in chapter 2, right around verse 12. The Bible says that we were a people who had no hope. Peter, in his letter, wrote in 1 Peter in chapter 1 in verse 3 that we now have a living hope. You see, the hope that the Scriptures speak of is not the type of hope that we have on a regular basis. Say somebody says, "Hey, you think you're going to come over? I hope so." No, that's not the biblical hope. The biblical hope is confident expectation. And because we were a people who had no hope, and now we are a people who have a living hope, when Paul wrote Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 1 in verse 1, Paul said, "It is Christ who is our hope." It's only in Christ. It's only in Him that we have this hope, this confident expectation. Notice what else he goes on to say here. It says, "Let us hold fast the confession of our hope. Let us hold fast to this very hope that we have in Christ Jesus." And he goes on to say this, guys, listen, "without wavering, for he who promised is faithful." In other words, if we can just jot this down, wavering is not an option. You see, you have a hope. And it is a confident hope. And clearly the hope really lies within who God is. And notice what it says here in regard to holding on to this very thing. It says without wavering. Wavering is not an option. Why? Because the one who promised is faithful. Remember what the Bible says in 2 Corinthians in chapter 1 in verse 20, that all the promises of God are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. God is faithful. You know what else I love? Remember, as the Scriptures would teach us, that God even is faithful when we are faithless. That's amazing, right? The Bible goes on to say clearly that no matter the circumstance or situation you face in life, God is faithful. Your circumstances don't dictate God's faithfulness. 1 Corinthians in chapter 10 and verse 13 says, "No temptation has overcome us, such as common unto man." And as the Bible begins to say, this is the difficulty in our lives, right? We're being tested. We're being challenged. And what does it say here? That God doesn't allow us to go through more than what we cannot handle, right? Without providing the way of escape. You see, that's the faithfulness of God. So faithful, guys, that we can rest assured in this hope that we have in Him, that from beginning to end, God has everything in control. Why? Because He is sovereign, and He loves His people, and His hand is upon all of us. For the Christian to live this victorious Christian life, it's called a radical faith because, as it's been mentioned earlier, we serve a radical God. And it's mind-blowing because I've been asked the questions, you know, like, how should we live? Look at all the stuff that's going on around and, you know, where are we? Who cares? God's in control, at least of us. And he's sovereign, and it's a great opportunity for us to live out this radical faith even more so now than ever. And notice what else comes along with this. It goes on to say here that he who promised is faithful. Remember when Paul wrote to the Thessalonian believers in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 in verse 24. Remember in verse 23, he says, "Now may the Lord God sanctify you spirit, soul, and body." As he begins to speak on God's faithfulness, he also says in verse 24 that the Lord is faithful. Paul was telling the Thessalonian believers, rest in the faithfulness of God. It is a sure foundation. And really the hope is that we don't have to live this Christian faith wavering. Why? Because it's faith in God. He is faithful. So wavering is not an option. If we waver, then we're not putting our faith in God. Because the one who promised is faithful. Talk about a sure foundation. Amen? Notice what else it goes on to say in verse 24. It says, let us consider one another in order to stir up. The word here in the original language, stir up, literally means to provoke. Some translations say that. To provoke. Now, sometimes we look at provoking in a negative sense, but here in the original language, it's provoking in a positive sense. To provoke you to what? Notice it says, stir up love and good works. To provoke you to trust in the Lord, to hold fast, to not waver, to do good, to trust in what God says because he is faithful. And if he says it, consider it done. You see, God's not up there going along in our Christian walk, and he's not up there just still figuring things out as we go. He knows the beginning from the end. Just think about that for a moment. He's faithful and he's able. Let me read to you what Jude wrote in Jude chapter 1 in verses 24 and 25. Listen to what is said here. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty and dominion and power both now and forever. Amen. To him who is able. He's able. He's the one who gives the promises. And his promises are sure. All the promises of God are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. Now consider just this now as we kind of look. In verse 1 of chapter 11, the Bible says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not yet seen. This is what faith is. None of us have seen Jesus, right? And I get in trouble for this even at our church. You know, when I tell them, you know, this picture of this guy you have in your house, that's not Jesus. And that's a creepy Jesus, too, because with the eyes follow you when you walk, you know, it's like still looking at me. You know, that's not the Jesus of the Bible. Just think about this for a moment. And you know, you got to understand my church predominantly Hispanic. So, you know, they come from the Catholic. Oh, they still got Jesus on the cross. You know, it's like, you know, they come to our church and like the cross, Jesus is not on it. Well, because he's not. He's been risen from the dead. But you see, so now I got to kind of get through this whole thing. And I says, you know, that Jesus, you know, that's not him. And some of them are like, that's blasphemy. I've had this picture in my family. Well, hey, if you want to keep it up, that's all good, man. But it's not him. It's not him. There's no description of Jesus in the Bible. The description we do get of him is that he was beaten and wounded for our transgressions. But if there was descriptions of Jesus, trust me, in our human nature, in our flesh, we would erect a shrine immediately and begin to worship this image rather than Christ. But notice something. That's what faith is, right? Believing in what you do not see. Believing in Jesus by faith. And notice what faith does. Faith does some great things for us. As a matter of fact, that's what it goes on to say. It says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for. Faith gives us hope. It gives us this confident expectation. Faith does this for us that the world cannot do for us. As a matter of fact, the hope that the world offers is a hope that'll fail you time and time again if you put your trust in it. But faith gives us hope. Notice verse 2, it says, "For by it the elders obtained a good testimony." You know that faith gives you also a good testimony. I'll share a story with you guys on that. When I was paroled from prison, my last prison term, and I got home, and typically when I got out of jail or out of prison, I would go to my mom's house, typical thing. She was always the one that was always there for me when I was incarcerated. None of my homeboys, none of my friends, nobody took care of me but my mom. And I got out, so that's where I would go. I'd pay my respects. I'd go to mom's house, not to live there, not to stay, because I was a dope fiend. You know, well, this last time when I got out, the Lord had did a radical miracle in my life. And I was no longer addicted to meth and to heroin. And typically when I would get out, I would go home, I would shoot up with my brother, and then I would just run the streets and probably be out maybe about a month and get incarcerated again. This was the typical lifestyle. You know, being in gangs and being in prison, yeah, I wasn't afraid to go to jail or afraid to go to prison. And I remember at the age of 18 years old, I was fighting a 40-year-to-life sentence, and I was acquitted on 4 counts of attempted murder, and I thought I was untouchable. But I wasn't untouchable. God had a purpose and God had a plan. And I'll never forget the day my mom went to go visit me, and she's crying, and she tells me, "You know, son, you're not going to spend the rest of your life in prison." And here I am facing all this time. And I tell her, "Well, you know, did you give me an attorney? Did you give me a lawyer? What did you give me?" You know what I mean? Because, like, I'm done. You know, and we didn't have no money. I'm thinking, man, maybe she went and sold tamales or something like that. Because that's what Mexicans do. That's what Mexicans do when you don't got enough money. You go sell tamales, you know, and then you raise your money. And so I'm thinking, like, man, she's probably, poor thing out there, you know, just busting them tamales out like crazy, you know, and got an attorney. She said, "No." She says, "You know what, son?" She goes, "When you were a little boy, when you were 5 years old," she goes, "I took you to a revival, to the church that we were at." She says, "And the people were getting prayed for, and you said, 'Mom, I want prayer.' And so," she goes, "I took you up there, and as I walked you up there," she goes, "that minister spoke a word over you, and he said that you were going to preach the gospel and that you were going to be a pastor." She goes, "And he also told me that there was going to be a period in your life where it looked like this wasn't going to happen, but for me to hold fast to the promises of God, and it will take place." And when she told me that, I called her every foul name you can think of. I says, "I don't need you. I don't need your God. I don't need your Jesus. I don't need, why are you even bringing this up?" I slammed the phone. I walked away. I was horrible with my mom. And 2 weeks later, after the jury was already selected, picking jury selection, I'm over here trying to pick the ones that I think would favor in my side. I was done. We go to the court, and next thing you know, the public defender comes to me and he says, "Hey, before you go in the courtroom," he goes, "I got good news and I got bad news." I says, "Okay, well, you know, what's the bad news?" He's like, "You're going to prison." "Man, okay. Well, what's the good news?" He says, "You're being acquitted on the 4 counts of attempted murder." I said, "Why?" He says, "There's no one here to turn state evidence against you. They don't want to tell on you because they feel that their lives are in danger if they do. You know, you're a gang member, and it's just the thing that they don't do." And all of a sudden, I said, "So what does that mean, man? Like, you know what? I don't care, whatever they want. What does that mean? I'm not going to get charged." He's like, "You're not going to get charged." "I don't know the legal system." I said, "All right, so then what do I do?" He's like, "Well, you just got to take this deal. You just got to sign here." And I says, "Wait, how much time am I doing?" He says, "You're going to do about 5 years. Maybe with half time, you'll be all right." I'm like, "I'll sign right now." And as I signed, and I thought, like, man, you know, this is, wow, you know, I'm a lucky guy, you know? As I started to walk away, check this out. You know the thought that popped in my mind? What if God is real and my mom is right? That like ruined the whole thing right there for me, man. So I knew right there the Lord had already started calling upon me, and now my mom sits third row, same seat, every service. I'm a product of a praying mother. And there might be some of you mothers, fathers, grandparents, siblings, sons, and daughters. Don't stop praying for your loved ones, for your friends. There is hope. As long as God is in control, God is still in the business of changing and transforming lives, and He can change them. And I'll tell you what, my mom doesn't even have to cry to hear the testimony. She cries almost every service just watching me preach because she knew what the Lord had told her since I was a little boy. God's faithful, amen? He's faithful. So I go to the house and I go into the room with my brother and I tell him, "Hey, man, I'm good. And he looks at me, he says, "You're what?" I says, "Yeah, I'm good. I go, you know, I'm a Christian." "You're what?" I said, "Yeah," and I walked out. And for years, my brother hated me. For years, he hated me. Running the streets, strung out on drugs. Hardest thing to do was just to turn him over and leave him in God's hands. His help that he wanted from me was money. And when you don't give him money, you're this, you're that. You ain't a Christian. You ain't no man of God. You're dead to me. And, you know, all this stuff. You love those people more than me. And all this, I heard it all. Cussed out, everything. Last time he came by the church, strung out. We were having a church barbecue. The people in the church know him. They offered him a plate of food. He stood there. He was eating. He was standing in front of the church by himself. I walk up to him, and I says, "How you doing, bro?" And he just says, he goes, "You know, I just I need some help." And I already knew what he was going to ask for. And I says, "Well, look, I can't help you, but here's what I want you to do. Go get plugged into a church. And if you can go get plugged into a church, then you want to know what? I'll help you, bro." And he says, "Why does it always have to be that with you? You know, the whole thing now. Why does it always have to be God?" I said, "Well, can I just pray for you?" He says, "Yeah." And I said, "Lord, you do whatever you have to do to bring him to the place where he has nowhere else to turn but you." And you want to know what? A week later, he gets arrested. And he's in prison for a couple of years. He calls me right before he paroles, and this is what he says, guys. He says, "David," he says, "I've watched you for almost 16 years. And your faith in God has brought me to a place that I realized I need Jesus. I need what you have." He says, "Your faith in God, faith, the elders of Cain, a good testimony. That's what brought my brother to the Lord." And guess what? I made sure I was there to pick him up. I drove up to Northern California, picked him up right out of prison, and took him straight into our recovery program. And this last July, he graduated after his year commitment, and he's serving at our church. Awesome. A good testimony. A good testimony. Notice what else it says here. "By faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which are visible." Faith also gives us an understanding of God and of his word and of who he is. Guys, listen. Remember what the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4 in verse 2. The Bible says, "For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard," listen, "did not profit them, not being mixed with faith." We have understanding of who God is, of his purpose, of his plan, of what he desires to do. Now listen, guys, it doesn't mean we understand everything about God, but we understand how God works, right? God doesn't give us, he never gives us like the big picture. In other words, saying, "Hey, well, we're going to do this, and we're going to do this, and you're going to go here, and you're going to go there." No, the Lord just says, "Go." But what about, don't worry about what about. I just told you to go. Now look at what happens now as we come. Look at verse 8. Let's turn our attention there. It says this. We're going to look at Abraham's life for a moment. And really, you could look at this from Genesis chapter 12 all the way to Genesis 22, as a matter of fact. You could look at all of this, what's written here, just in these couple of verses. The Bible says, now with all of this, understanding this very hope, see, Abraham is a perfect example of one who is holding on, who is holding fast to his confession of this hope that he has in the Lord. Abraham is a perfect picture of one who is not wavering, because he knows that the one who promised is faithful. Look at what it says in verse 8. It says, "By faith Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place which he would receive as an inheritance, and he went out not knowing where he was going. By faith, he dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise." Here's what I love about this picture here. We know the story of Abraham, right? He comes from the land of the Chaldeans. Now, guys, if you study, you'll see that the land where Abraham came from, you know, the God of Israel, and to even use that term, we got to use it lightly because Israel didn't exist yet. But the God of Scripture wasn't the only God that was worshipped. There were many that were worshipped. And the God of Scripture called out, and Abraham responded. And this is what God said, "Abraham, leave your comfort. Leave your home. Leave everything you know. Leave your complacency. And go to a land that I've promised you. Go." What we find here is that Abraham embraced the very words of him who promises. And the Bible says the one who promises is faithful. It was the very word It was God's word that led Abraham, and the Bible reveals to us here that Abraham believed God by faith when he didn't know where. He didn't know where he was going, but he believed God by faith, and he went. And sometimes God is calling you to go. Now, it might not be physically leave here, the highland, you know, and go somewhere else. No, but God might also be calling you to go to a different phase in your walk with the Lord. In your marriage, in your own personal life. God might be telling you to go to someone or to some people. God might be stretching you and saying, and you might be trying to figure it all out. Well, Lord, if I do that, then the Lord's not asking you to try to figure it out. He's just saying, go. Will you trust me? You see, God's track record is not a track record of wavering. Ours is. His is not. The promises of God, the Bible says, are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. It's a sure foundation. If God is saying to go and God is saying to do, then you do it. In other words, I guess the best thing we can learn from all of this is this. Obey the command and God will take care of the promise. Simple as that. And look at what happens here. Abraham doesn't know where, but the Lord says go, and Abraham goes. I love verse 9. The Bible says here that he went to the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents. The emphasis has to be made here. Abraham dwelt in a tent. Not only did he go, but he dwelt in a tent. Think about this. Abraham didn't build no known city or this or nothing like that. He dwelt in tents. As a matter of fact, when you look at this here, you'll see that only those who dwelt in tents were called one type of word, and that is pilgrim, because their citizenship is not here. Remember when Paul told the Philippians in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 20, your citizenship is where? In heaven. It was the whole understanding that even Jesus spoke in the Gospels when he said, store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, because where your treasures are, your heart will be also. Don't store up for yourselves treasures here on earth where moth and rust destroy. Can I just paraphrase this whole thing and break it down into one simple phrase? God will outlive everything. So store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. This is really what Abraham was doing. You see, the word here, pilgrim, when you kind of consider this word, just think about this for a moment. The term tent is kind of an interesting term, because you go all throughout Scripture, you'll even see Peter. Remember at the end of his life, what did he say? I'm about to lay down this tent. As a matter of fact, when you look at John chapter 1 and in verse 14, and the Bible says, and the word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory as only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. When it says, and the word became flesh, in the original language, it means, and he pitched his tent among us, because it's not our permanent dwelling place. And the word, it's an interesting word. When you go to 1 Peter and you look at chapter 1, remember when Peter is addressing the church, he calls them pilgrims. It's derived of two words. The first word is para. The second word is epidemos. Para epidemos is the Greek word for pilgrim. And it's an interesting word. Why? Because para means alongside. Parable. Jesus spoke in parables. The parakletos, the Holy Spirit, coming alongside, right? But the term epidemos means alien or foreigner. So the term pilgrim in Scripture means a alien alongside, or a foreigner alongside. Well, that's you and I. You see, I could preach this good back home. Why? Because within our congregation, there's some illegal aliens, if you catch my drift. Now, I can get away with it because I'm Mexican. You know what I'm saying? So I can get the get down. You know what I mean? And so I'll throw this out there, and I says, you know, now there might be some illegal aliens in here, and it gets like real holy quiet. And then I tell them, don't worry, the migra ain't in here. That's the immigration. I said, don't worry about that. I says, but did you all know that we're all illegal aliens? And then they're like, yeah, we are. You know, and I says, you are. If you have been bought and purchased with the blood of Jesus Christ, you are a para epidemos. You are a pilgrim. You are an alien alongside who? The natives of this earth. You're just passing through. You're a pilgrim. And one day you're going to have to lay down this tent, because your permanent dwelling place is in heaven. You see, Abraham got it. And he was dwelling in tents. He believed God by faith when he didn't know where. He just went. I love that kind of faith. You know what I mean? You know what I say? It says, like, man, I was a fool in the world, and I love being a fool for Jesus. If the Lord points, I go. I love that. Because God already has it all worked out already. You don't got to ask the questions, right? You just trust the Lord. And this is kind of what Abraham did here. He believed by faith when he didn't know where. And notice, guys, here that even when he dwelt in the land that the Lord had promised, he didn't even dwell permanently there. Because Abraham had something else in mind. Abraham knew that the one who promised was faithful, and Abraham knew that one day he would be with the one who promised. That's all Abraham cared about. And you want to know what's interesting about Abraham's life? I didn't make this point in the last couple of services, but listen, Abraham was a very wealthy man. And that wasn't the thing that kept Abraham going. It was his faith. That's why we give Abraham the title, the father of faith. The little kids sing that song, Father Abraham had many sons, had Father Abraham, and I am one of them, and so are you. You remember that? You're teaching them about Abraham, the father of faith, that he believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness' sake. Notice that. And then the Bible goes on to say, for he waited for a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Abraham was committed to looking forward in trusting God's word. He was looking for that day. Guys, we need to be looking for that day that we will be with Christ Jesus. Amen? Jesus is coming back. Amen? Like one or two are like, yeah. No, listen, you got to rejoice in the fact that Christ is coming back. Some people, you know, they're kind of like, well, can he wait a little bit? You know, I left the lights on at home. The dog has to get fed. Hey, we're out of here. He could come today. We could be gone. And we could be at the feet of Jesus worshiping. I mean, isn't that what we're living for on this side of heaven? We're living to ultimately be with Christ, whether it happens by rapture or by the departure of death. Either way, ultimately, we're like Abraham. What are we doing? We're waiting for a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. That's what you're looking to. So on this side of heaven, I'm not saying, hey, you know what? You know, don't live this life in a way that, you know, forget about your job, forget about it. No, listen. There's nothing wrong with possessions, but when your possessions begin to possess you, that's the problem. And trust me, I know some very wealthy Christians, and they all have one thing in common. One thing in common, they're givers. They're givers. They have no problem giving what God has given them, and they're able to advance the kingdom in other areas that others cannot, and that's why they're where they're at. But think about this for a moment. When you look at Abraham here, guys, listen, Abraham was so fixed and focused on all that God had promised him. And then look at what else happens now in Abraham's life. First, he left, right? And he believed God when he didn't know where. And look at verse 11. By faith, Sarah herself also received strength to conceive seed, and she bore a child when she was past the age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, and that's a literal translation, were born as many as the father or stars of the sky, in multitudes innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. Abraham and Sarah were way past the age of having children. They're pushing 100 here, man. Think about that today. No, don't think about that. Anyways. It's crazy. No, just listen. This is a miracle, man. We know the story. What did not Sarah laugh? She didn't laugh because she didn't think God was able. She laughed because she knew that she wasn't able. Abraham believed God by faith when he didn't know how. Not how it was going to happen, but he didn't know how. You know, we're past the age. You know, on a note on this here, I remember, you know, like today, you know, me and my wife, we had our kids young. They're teenagers. Two of them already graduated high school. Me and my wife are still in our 30s. So we're going to be young grandparents, you know. And I tell my wife, you know, I'm glad we had them young, you know. Well, but when you're already like pushing like 50 and you have a surprise, it's kind of like, whoa, you know. Not that 50's old. It's not. But you don't start a family at 50 and 60, right? You don't. You're like, you're already enjoying grandkids, right? Well, I had a friend of mine, an assistant pastor at a church, and yeah, they were pushing that age group there, and they had a surprise. So when I seen him, you know, orale means what's up. And I seen him, I go, orale, Abraham. And he caught it. He started cracking up. You know what I mean? But listen, they were past that age. And Abraham, by faith, believed God when he didn't know how. Isn't that amazing? He didn't ask God, well, have you seen Sarah, Lord? Have you seen? He didn't ask that. He believed God by faith, and guess what it was? Faith gave them the strength to have a child. You see what faith does for you and I? Guys, listen, the promises of God are fulfilled immediately or ultimately. What we can rest assured in is if God promised it, he who has promised is faithful. Amen? Look at verse 13 very quickly. It says, these all died in faith. Remember, prior to Abraham, we see a list of those who had lived a life of faith. This is why we call Hebrews chapter 11 the hall of faith. We're just focusing on Abraham's life. But when it says all these, it's talking about all those that have already been mentioned, including Abraham, died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed them, that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. And truly, if they had all called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return, but now they desire a better, that is a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. You see, guys, they died, some of them not even receiving the fulfillment of the promise, but it doesn't mean that God was not faithful. The promise was probably not going to be fulfilled in their lifetime. And what if they die? They died in faith, holding on to the promise. Think about that for a moment. You see, your circumstance doesn't change God's faithfulness. And you might be saying, well, I'm praying and I'm going to pray till the day I die. That's a literal statement. Pray till the day you die, because those are your prayers. And just because you die doesn't mean that your prayers die. God is faithful. And he's not moved by somebody departing from this life and stepping into eternity. He is faithful. He's not caught off guard like, oh my goodness, they just died. What do I do? Well, I guess there goes all their prayers. No, it doesn't work that way. He's faithful to the very end. That's the great thing about the Lord. You have something, guys, that is far greater. Listen, you're not better than the people out there that don't know the Lord. And by no means are we better than them, but we are better off because of who we have and because of who we put our faith in. And you want to know what? Get out there and let them know about the one in whom you've put your faith and your trust. Notice what we see here. They held on to the promise, it says here, from afar off. They embraced it. And notice what it says in verse 16, but now they desire a better. You notice that their desire for a better thing is a result of the promises of God. Did you know that? Take note of that. Abraham believed God by faith when he didn't know when. He didn't know when the promises were going to be fulfilled, but he knew that they ultimately would be fulfilled because the one who promised is faithful. So Abraham believed God by faith when he didn't know where, when he didn't know how, and when he didn't know when. But notice how our desires change when we put our faith and trust in God. It's like these misinterpreted passages of Scripture that many people quote. You know, when somebody's coming and saying, oh, you know, I just need God to, you know, move in my life in this situation. And they say, hey, you want to know what? God will give you the desires of your heart. No, that's not true. The passage says, delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. No, God just doesn't give you. Man, what are your desires this morning? Thank God that he doesn't just give us the desires of our heart, because in our sinful nature, at times our desires are so far from what God represents and what he is. But when you delight yourself in the Lord, when you look to the promises of God and you find joy and you take pleasure and you rest in his faithfulness and his goodness, let me tell you something. Your desires begin to change because of who God is, not because of who you are. And guess what? God will give you the desires of your heart, because guess who's putting those desires there? When you delight yourself in the Lord, he puts new desires in your heart. And all you're doing is speaking those desires out that God has put there. Yes, he will give you the desires of your heart if you delight yourself in the Lord. It's only in delighting yourself in the Lord. It's like that other passage. You know, trust me, you know, we have a recovery ministry, so they come and they say, Pastor, I'm being tempted. And I was, you know, young brothers, you know, hey, they're just trying to encourage them. They're like, bro, you got to resist the devil and he'll flee from you. No, the Bible says submit to God, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. The only way you can resist the devil is by submitting to God. Because in your own strength, dude, you're no match. He'll chew you up, spit you out, beat you up, beat you down. That's just what he does. That's his MO. But if you submit to God, in him you have all you need. Notice something, guys. What are your desires today? What is it that you desire the most? Are your desires are the things that point clearly to the Lord? But now they desire a better, that is a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Remember what Jesus said in John chapter 14? Let not your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. And remember, Jesus goes on to explain to them, and I go to prepare a place for you. And he says, and if I do, which he was, I'm going to come back for you. And I'm going to receive you unto myself. There is a place that has been prepared for the saints of God. That's what you have. You know, guys, listen. We're on this side of heaven, yeah, living in a fallen world. For what purpose? So that we can live this life of radical faith so that God gets the glory in our lives. Isn't that what it's about? So that others will see Jesus. And how will people know that Jesus is at work in our life if we're not living this life of faith? Your Christian walk has to go from just sitting into service after service, but now applying what you learn and saying, you know what, God, I'm going to believe you by faith because this is what your word says. And I'll tell you what, there are things that have removed that ability to live that life of faith in the lives of many Christians, fear being one of them. And I'll tell you what, God cannot work in your life if you're not willing to trust. Remember, a whole generation died in the wilderness because the Bible says of unbelief. You know, when you stop believing in the promises of God and in his faithfulness, you begin to die. Did you know that? You begin to die. And now your walk with God, guys, it becomes something not like this life of faith. You know, you guys probably think, well, yeah, you know, he's a guest speaker. He's coming in. He's gonna rile us up. No, I'm always like this. And I'm always like this at our church. I've been this excited for Jesus since the day I gave my life to Christ. It hasn't changed. Because God is radical. And this faith that we have is radical. Do I get discouraged? Of course I do. Have I had times of doubt? Of course I have. Have I felt like giving up? Many times. But has my faith ever wavered? It can't. It's impossible because the one who gave it to me as a gift is sure and solid. And that's why this faith is a faith that we can rest assured in, that God is in control. By faith, Abraham believed God when he didn't know where. Some of you, that's speaking to you this morning. By faith, Abraham believed God when he didn't know how. To others, that's speaking to you also. By faith, Abraham believed God when he didn't know when. You see, what kept Abraham where he needed to be with the Lord is that he trusted in the promises of God. He knew God was faithful. Notice something else we see in verse 17. It says, by faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac, and he who had received the promises offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said, in Isaac your seed shall be called, concluding that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from which he also received him in a figurative sense. Now, this is a pretty radical story. It's found in Genesis chapter 22. And in verse 2, we see where the Lord speaks to Abraham and he says, Abraham, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love. That's the first time the word love is ever used in Scripture. Genesis chapter 2, verse 22. The last time is in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 11. And they did not love their lives to the death. Notice the bookend of Scripture. Both speaking about sacrifice. That's what the gospel, that's what the whole Bible is. Sacrifice, Jesus giving his life. Think about that for a moment here. And now Abraham is asked to offer up his son, Isaac, the one that we just read about, that him and his wife were well advanced in age to even have kids, and the Lord is saying, you're going to have a son. Now the Lord is asking him later on in his life, to offer up this son as a sacrifice. Well, we know the story. Abraham doesn't have this, okay, son, we got to have a talk. No, he says, hey, we're going. They go. He has his servants with him. I love when they hit the base of the mountain, Abraham turns to his servants and he says, me and the lad will be back. That's amazing right there. Me and the lad will be back. In other words, we're going to go up there. Nobody knew what was going on, but Abraham said, we will be back. Now, Genesis doesn't tell us anything that Abraham concluded. Hebrews chapter 11 does. And it says this. It says, at that moment, guys, concluding Abraham, verse 19, that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from which he also received him in a figurative sense. Now, I don't know about you guys, but has it ever occurred to you that nobody had been raised from the dead at this point in time in Scripture, and Abraham believed that God could raise Isaac up from the dead? Talk about radical faith. It hadn't even happened yet. And yet he was like, I know God can do this. Because God's promise was that I was going to be a father of many nations. You see, Abraham believed God by faith when he didn't know why. He didn't know why God was asking him to do this. But the picture is so beautiful because faith is not just for the present. Faith is also for the future. And notice something here as you look at this. Now remember, they go up the mountain, right? There's Isaac. He has the wood. He's going up. He got it on his back. They get to the top of the mountain, Mount Moriah, the mountain that God told him to go to. We know the story. I'm just paraphrasing. And the next thing you know, as they're getting everything ready, Isaac goes up to his dad. He says, hey, dad, you know, we have the altar. We have the fire. We got everything. Where's the sacrifice? Abraham's like, well, you know, son, I wanted to talk to you about that. No. Listen, then the Bible just goes on to say what? That he lays him on the altar, right? Straps him down. And he tells his son, the Lord will provide for himself the lamb. Well, now here is Isaac on this mountain. Guys, listen, Abraham believed God by faith when he didn't know why. And Abraham now is bringing up the knife and ready to thrust it into his son. And the angel of the Lord calls out to Abraham, 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 do not hurt the lad. And Abraham stops. Isaac's like, whoo, you know what I'm saying? And the next thing you know, a ram is caught in the thicket. And the Lord tells Abraham, now the Lord knows that you love him. See, this was more for Abraham than it was for the Lord. But let me tell you something. They get the ram. Isaac's probably like, whoo, that was me just a couple of minutes ago. They put him on the altar. They sacrifice this ram. They offer it up to the Lord. And check this out. Abraham had told Isaac the Lord would provide a lamb. But it was a ram that was caught in the thicket. What happened to the lamb? Abraham is a man of faith, right? Believing in the promises of God. Is he speaking for God? Is he lying? No. God is faithful. 2,000 years later, Jesus comes on the scene. He's walking down to the Jordan. John the Baptist sees him, and his first statements are, behold the Lamb. That echoes all the way back 2,000 years, because he used the word the before the word lamb as the definite article in the original language, meaning not just any lamb, but a certain type of lamb, a lamb that had already been spoken of, and it was the lamb that Abraham said that God would provide. And John says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And when Jesus was crucified, he went up that same mountain, Mount Moriah, with the wood on his back, just like Isaac did, and gave his life as a sacrifice. There was the lamb that Abraham said God would provide. Trip out on the faith that Abraham had. It wasn't only for present, but it was also for future. Can I tell you that the faith that you have in Christ Jesus, God can reach far into the future. Don't worry about that. You believe God by faith when you don't know where, when you don't know how, when you don't know when, and when you don't know why. Just believe by faith. Trust in him. He's able to do it. And God desires for you to live out this radical faith, because God wants to live through us so that he gets the glory and that he's glorified. And he's given us his spirit and the ability to do it by the work and ministry of the Holy Spirit. And that's why sometimes you don't see radical things happening, because you know what? They're just thinking like, well, you know, that was in biblical times. You guys are doing a study through the book of Acts. The book of Acts was written over a period of 30 years. When you read it in one setting, you're like, miracle after miracle, bam, 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 man, that's exciting. How come that's not happening in the church today? Well, guess what? It's written over a period of 30 years. Now, when you look at it from that perspective, you're like, wow, they're kind of far in between. Let me tell you something. The work and ministry of the Holy Spirit is still here today for the church so that God can receive all the glory. Let me tell you something about signs and wonders. The Bible says in Mark's Gospel, chapter 16, and verse 17, that signs and wonders follow them that believe. You don't go and chase signs and wonders. They follow you because of your faith in Christ and because the work and ministry of the Holy Spirit. And remember, Jesus made a promise. He promised the work and ministry of the Holy Spirit. Guys, listen. Live this life of faith like never before. Live it like never before. Notice what we see here. Our faith is always challenged, and the enemy hates when we live this dynamic, radical faith. Do you know that? You remember there in the book of Acts, chapter 19, I believe, the seven sons of Sceva. You remember, listen, guys, as you read, you're going to get through it, but you're going to see they try to go out and they try to do what the disciples and the apostles were doing, right? So they go and they try to cast a demon out. And when they go and try to cast this demon out, just one guy, there's seven of them. And next thing you know, the demon manifests and begins to speak to them. And this is what he tells them. Paul, we know. Jesus, we know. But who are you? Uh-oh. We know the rest of the story. They were beat up. They were, you'll read it. It's kind of funny, but it's real. Paul and Jesus had a reputation in hell because they lived the life of faith. Do you have a reputation in hell? Do they know that you're a woman, that you're a man of faith, that you want to know what the schemes of the enemy don't work on you because you're so fixed and focused on the promises of God that wavering is not an option for you? Or are you one who wavers? Listen, that's okay. It happens. Sometimes things get in the way of what God is doing in your life. And guess what? It's not that God is limited. We limit the work of God in our life because we don't trust in God's ability to do. Did we not just read that God is able? Imagine Abraham, man, if he was here telling the story himself and saying, this is what I was going through. This is what I was experiencing. I want to ask you today, if there's anyone here tonight that has never accepted, or this morning, that has never accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and you want to know this Jesus that we're speaking about, you want to have this faith that we're talking about, it's only found in Christ Jesus. And this message clearly is for you. You don't know Jesus. You've never accepted him as your Lord and Savior. And you're saying, you know what, Pastor David? Man, that's amazing. But I want to know this Jesus. I know of him, but I don't know him. And I want to know him as Lord and Savior of my life. And if you're here this morning and that's you, I would like for you just to raise your hand very quickly all across this place. If there's anybody here that does not, you've never accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you would like to do that this morning. Is there anyone here all across this place? Raise your hand, and you feel that little tugging on your heart. Friend of mine, that's the Holy Spirit, and he's tugging on your heart. Anybody in here, you've never accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior? And I like to do this, why? Because I don't just assume that everybody that comes to church is born again. There's a gal who was sitting in the back row at your guys' Saturday night service that said she had been going to church, but she'd never accepted Christ as her Lord and Savior. And last night was her night, she said, and she accepted Jesus for the first time. But here's another group that I want to talk to today. You might say, you know what, Pastor Dave, I have accepted Christ, but I can be honest with you, I haven't been living this life of faith. I've been wavering. And things have gotten in the way. And yeah, you know what, we use the term backslidden. Yes, you've probably backslidden. Listen, it was told to me years ago, early on in my Christian faith, David, if you don't love Jesus Christ more today than you did yesterday, you're already backslidden in your heart. See, the church today doesn't embrace stuff like that because, oh, I just can't believe that. No, you better believe it. Jesus has to be everything. If he's not the Lord of all, then he's not the Lord at all. And so I'm going to ask you today, if you could be honest in your heart, and you might think backslider is a bad word. No, it's not a bad word. Read Jeremiah chapter 3. The Bible says, I, the Lord your God, am married to the backslider. All the Lord is saying is come back. Come back. Turn away from your backsliding. Come back to that place, that fellowship, when it was fresh, when it was real, when it was passionate. Come back. And if that's you this morning, you say, Pastor Dave, that's me. I'm not going to ask you to bow your head and close your eyes. I don't do that. Some people say, why don't you do that? You know, it's personal. Well, when I got jumped into a gang, they didn't say, hey, homie, come here, bow your head, close your eyes, we're going to jump you in. They didn't do that. They were like, you know, you want in? Okay, come on, you know? Listen, if you want to get right with God, it should never matter to you what man thinks of you. Don't worship man, worship God. And if that's you this morning and you say, Pastor Dave, I need that prayer. That is me. And the Spirit of the Lord is tugging on your heart. He's saying, there, stand to your feet. If that's you here this morning, stand to your feet. I want to pray with you. Anybody here across this place, stand to your feet. Everybody's always worried about the first one. It's always that first one. Like, you know, somebody else stand. Somebody else stand. No, stand. Anybody else, stand to your feet. Listen. I believe there's a couple more. And as the Spirit of the Lord is pricking at your heart now, and he's saying, listen, you need to be standing to your feet. You know what that's about. Because there's probably been something you've been praying about, something you've been doing, and something that's been hindering. And you know what the Lord is saying? Let's take care of this now. Let's deal with it now. If that's you, stand to your feet. Please, stand to your feet. I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, if that's you, stand to your feet. Anybody else? God bless you. Is there any more honest hearts here this morning? Anybody else? God bless you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Amen. Amen. Now, this is what we're going to do, guys. You notice that there's somebody standing next to you. Believer, we're the body of Christ. We're a family. I love the term as it's being used here. This is what we use all the time. Your fellow brother, your fellow sister is standing next to you. As a body of believers, let's get around them. Get out of your seat. Let's get around them. We're going to pray with them. Go ahead. Let's do that now. Let's do that now. Let's do that now. We're going to pray with them. We're going to pray with them. Now listen, for those of you that stood up, I want you to just repeat this prayer with me. We're going to pray together. We're going to seek the Lord. And for those of you that are standing around, those that have stood up, we're going to pray with them. Because as a body, we do things together. And so we're going to pray this together along with them. And for those of you that stood up, as you pray this, trust me, your prayer really is an act of faith this morning. And you're saying, Lord, here I am. Take my life. Use it for your honor and for your glory. So let's pray that this morning. You pray, repeat after me. Those that stood up and those of us that are with them, let's pray with them. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you this morning that your word is truth, that your Spirit is power, that has convicted my heart, that has pointed the things out that have separated me from you. Lord, forgive me of my sin, of the things that have taken your place in my life. Lord, fill me afresh with the work and ministry of the Holy Spirit. And Lord, from this day forward, I recommit, I rededicate, I reaffirm my confession of hope without wavering. Because Lord, you're faithful. And so, Lord, I stand upon the promises of your word. I thank you, Lord, for forgiving me. I thank you, Lord, for empowering me. In Jesus, I thank you for the work of the cross. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you guys. Thank you.
Awesome.
Were you blessed? Told you. And so, any one of you that said, how come you're not preaching? There, now you know why. Okay? So there it is. But you know what's so fun is he didn't know about my sermon last week. I told him nothing about the message. But we have the same boss. And his total challenge is, as I said last week, are we good people or God people? Are we good Christians or God Christians? As we seek to settle. And yet the challenge today is what faith does is it brings about radical faith. And so I ask you today, is your faith radical? Because if it's not radical, then what is it? I think that's a fair question to ask. If it's not radical, then what is it? Because that's the faith that God calls. And you see, a radical faith is a radical departure from sin. It's a radical focus on. You see, the entire message today was about faith, but you missed it if you didn't understand that it's not faith in faith, but it's faith in God. It's a faith when you don't know who, you don't know where, you don't know when You don't know how and you don't know why, but you do know the one who is calling you, and that's your Father, Jesus Christ. Amen? There's the key. That's what he was talking about. And I loved it. I loved it when he challenged us and said, hey, we who are walking in Christ, we are no better than any of those around us, but we are better off. We have something to give. And what did Amy Carmichael challenge us last week? That, hey, you can give without loving, but you can't love without giving. And what does that really, really look like in our lives? And so the whole point that we want to say is, Lord, I want to live this hope, this expectation of the coming good, because hope is not some philosophical, hope is a person. And that's that hope in Jesus Christ. And I got to tell you, you know, I was sitting there listening right there in this message last night, running through my mind the last, 18 hours of my life, because on Friday night, I did a wedding, Saturday morning, did a funeral, and Saturday afternoon, did a pre-prep meeting for our Israel trip of people getting ready to get on a plane to go all the way across the world. And my whole point is that every single one of those things is an element of faith, isn't it? Faith and a whole new marriage, and how are we going to become one, and two different worlds collide. And then the faith of a loved one, knowing that we will see them again, and the faith that will comfort those. And then faith of saying, God, you've called me to take this step of faith to go to a whole nother part of the world. This is the reality when we learn it, know it, and live it. Amen. That's the key. So get radical. Understand that is the only way to live. And I'm just going to say it this way, and that is the radical faith is the one that gets the radical blessing. God's promises are fulfilled either immediately or ultimately, but they are fulfilled. So Stephen lived it. He lived the sacrifice. Peter, John, Saul, who we're soon going to see Paul, lived it. Let's do the same. Amen. Father, I thank you for this time for us to be here today. And so, Lord, I pray that as we now say, Lord, what was this sermon for us? That we begin to now hear from you. Lord, where has there been the compromise? Where have we settled? Lord, help us, God, to increase our faith, not in faith, but in you. May our faith not even be in the calling, but the caller, because you have the right to change the calling at any time. And so maybe it was a season to this, and now it's a season to do that, a season to rest, or maybe a time of rest is over, and it's a season now to step up. But Father, what we want to say, what we want to know, is that we're walking in your word, your will, and your way. For Father, that is where fulfillment is found. So child of God, whether today you said, Lord, I recognize I have drifted and I come home. Hallelujah. What are the things that need to change? If today you are one that prayed with others, are we walking according to the faith that believes and is reckoned as righteous? What is the least? What is the most? What is the discernment that we have to choose with our priorities and our time? He's coming back, church. Scripture doesn't say, will we be found ready, as much as it says, will we be found faithful? Take a moment and listen to your King.
Hey, thank you for spending your time with us today at One Love Ministries and being a part of our program. But this invitation that you heard today through the Word of God is directly to you. And I want you to know, if you have not yet made a profession of faith, meaning ask Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior, that invitation is available to you right now. Change, transformation, all the glorious things that God wants to do are available to you, but you got to ask. You must personally invite Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior. So if God has been speaking to you during this message, your heart's been beating, your hands been getting kind of sweaty, you've been wrestling with things, guess what? That's the Lord knocking on your heart. And I want to lead you right now in a prayer that can allow you to invite Jesus Christ to become your Lord and Savior and open the door for eternity for you and Him to be together. I want you to pray with me right now. It's not a magic prayer, but an honest heart that will invite the Lord into your life. Join me right now. Dear Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. I ask you to forgive me and to become my Lord and Savior. Today, Jesus, I believe that you are God and that you saved me, and my faith will be put in you. Please give me your Holy Spirit to come in and upon me, that I might learn how to live as a child of God. Thank you, Jesus, for your love. And today, I come home. In your name I pray. Amen. If you prayed that prayer with us, we are excited. The Bible says the angels in heaven are rejoicing, and we want to join them too. So would you call this number right here on the bottom of the screen and let us know. We want to help you find a church that's in your area, get plugged in, get fellowship, get discipled, as the Bible says, because we want to grow in God's grace together. God bless you. He loves you. We're excited.
If you would like to receive a copy of today's message, please write down the sermon number on your screen and give us a call at 955-9335. For service times and locations, check us out on the web at onelove.org. Mahalo for watching.